Microphone over to, or is it adequate there? I'm asking the technician, the camera.
Maybe all right there.
It's okay there?
First of all, I'd like to acknowledge and to thank the team leaders and the staff members and Mary Ann Brown, the input that she was, that she provided. And also for the patience and guidance of Nancy St. John in putting together this budget this year. This is a new process for me here at CAPE, and I think every school system has its own history as far as putting budgets together. But in putting together a budget, there's always a connection to the past. The past being last year and years before that, and also the current history. I'd like to direct the board's attention to the overview, if you have that. And attached to that, there are two documents that I think that'll be helpful in understanding the presentation this evening. Two of them are color-coded. There's one that gives projections of numbers in classrooms, and the second is a floor plan looking at Conco for next year. History, looking at the history of this particular year, there are two things that I would like to call your attention to. And they involve two grade levels that would be moving to a new building. One kindergarten moving to the high school, and the fourth grade moving over from the intermediate unit. These are kinds of things that we had to keep in mind as the budget was prepared, and will certainly have an impact on the budget. There's also going to be involvement of movement throughout the buildings within Pond Cove itself. There will be some moving going on as well. There also will be changes and so forth involved with the curriculum, and you'll see those reflected in the budget this evening. Those are some things that are past history as they affect this budget coming up just within this past year. And then going back to last year, there are a number of things that affected the budget historically last year that I think that are important to keep in mind as we look at this year's budget. Last year, in 91-92, there were reductions that affected integrated arts, foreign language, and a variety of the instructional accounts, and also the number of sections that were offered at the two grade levels. These were part of last year's history. What I would really like to emphasize throughout this presentation, ask you to kind of just put as a framework, is that the number of kinds of things as far as change is concerned that are going to be happening in Pond Cove. It's very clear, I think, that there's change going on K through 12, but I think that it's very sharply affecting the Pond Cove staff. We began to put this budget together with this history back in December and talked with the team leaders. Nancy and I talked with team leaders about the changes that we saw that probably would be happening in the coming budget year. And with that background, that information, I'd like to then just proceed through the various accounts. And what I'll do is to stop along the way, and if there are questions that folks have, I think I probably will be following very closely this presentation that I have written. And then if there are questions as we go, please let me know. under the instructional account, and I would ask also that you have in front of you the two items of floor plan, because this actually affects this instructional account a great deal. The floor plan and also the projected numbers for class sizes for next year. The first document there is an analysis of the current and projected class sizes. On the left-hand side is the current year, and the right-hand side is the projections for 92-93. The second is a proposed floor plan that illustrates the way in which the space, which we really feel is a precious commodity at Klein Cove, this is a proposal for the way in which this space could be used. And you'll see, I think there, if you'll notice there's a correspondence with the numbers for the projected numbers for grade levels, and that connects with the floor plan. I think you'll see that every nook and cranny will be used there. All right, there are three rooms there that you'll see, which were formerly used, one for music, one for as a special education resource room, and a room that was used for, or has been used for integrated arts. And these, in this proposal, will become classrooms. The undesignated spaces, those are the ones that are not marked in color, will be occupied by special education services. And what I would like you to know, if you would, is that the special ed spaces at this point are few and far between. They're small areas. In fact, we haven't decided exactly where all the special ed services are going to be housed at this point. Also, I should point out that there's no room. The room that was used for music is gone from that floor plan. Art does remain. Staffing for next year has virtually remained pretty much unchanged, although the number of sections have shifted around to some degree. As it's proposed there, there'll be one less section in the first grade and the fifth grade, and one more section in second and fourth grades. This is on the proposal that you have there, the projected numbers. I think it's important, especially important, to notice what the projected enrollments might be for first grade. That is a grade that historically is impacted with more incoming students than any other grade level. We haven't figured out exactly why, but we've done some research. Mary Ann's provided me with some numbers, and it's very consistent practically every year. For about the last 4 or 5 years, there have been 7 or 8 students that have left in the summertime, and there has been an average between 20 to 25 that are incoming, which is a higher total than in any other grade level. We've talked about this at the team level. Nancy and I had looked at the floor plan and looked at the numbers and proposed a reduction at the first grade level. And in talking with team members this past week, I think there also is a possibility of leaving the numbers just as they are. In other words, leaving the current number of sections in first grade and the current number in second grade. And the primary reason for this, and this came out of a very strong consensus for both first and second grade, that first grade classes should be kept small. And second grade teachers have acknowledged this and are very, very supportive of that approach. So where that will go at this point, whether we will decide to do seven or eight, or whether it will be this plan here, we're not certain, but the ultimate outcome is still the same. We've also, Connie had mentioned the other evening in her overview that there were two teacher assistants that will be available, hopefully, at that grade level between one and two. How those will be distributed will probably be decided by the number of students that are enrolled next September. Probably I should stop at this point. That's a lot to observe. See if there are any questions before I go on to the educational development aspect.
Shall we stop the questions, or shall we just go on and interrupt, or would you prefer to wait until the whole presentation's open? Board?
I'd rather do it as she's going along so that we don't lose our thought if we have one at the time.
Okay, the only problem with that is that we want to make sure she gets finished. So why don't we just work together on that? Did you mind taking questions as they come up?
No, whichever is the most productive for you is.
Okay, are there any questions at this time?
What's that on the floor plan? I see the four moves in fairly nicely with three, grade three, and then the one and two, just in terms of flow of grades, it seems to be reversed. Is there any specific reason for that? And my next question is there anything about the physical characteristics of that part of the building that would be more apt to fit first graders as opposed to second graders? Is that size difference of significance?
Well, one of our primary concerns is because we're doing so much moving already, and first grade is pretty much settled where they are, we wanted to keep the movement down within the class, within Pond Cove that's already there. Unless there was a really significant reason for moving, we wanted to avoid that. That was part of the reason that was.
So for movement, primarily.
Yes.
And are there any problems in terms of adjusting that space going from K to the opposing problems?
We looked at the possibility of two going down to the, or four rather, moving into the kindergarten, and the facilities there are all kindergarten size facilities.
So, but second grade versus first grade is not significant in that consideration.
Actually, let me address the parliamentary aspect of this workshop a little bit on reflection. There are a lot of people here tonight, and we have two presentations. How long would yours be without questions?
15 minutes.
That's all. Good.
Nancy? Did you say 15 minutes?
Well, I'm not a very good estimate.
You've had about 15 minutes. So for another 15 to go?
That would do it.
I would say like half hour.
Half hour each. Okay. And how many people, just out of curiosity, from the public have questions already in their minds or would intend to ask questions as we went through this workshop? It's not, this is not binding. I will not call on you later on if you raise your hand now. One, two, three, four, five. Okay, well, feel free to, we'll stop at the end of your presentation then, and after the board has finished asking its questions, we'll take questions from the public for a while, and then we'll move into Nancy's presentation. Okay, everybody agree with that?
All right, I'll.
Actually, I have another question. As things are looking extremely tight on this presentation, one of the questions that occurred to me is the use of construction library and our media center, and some redundancy in terms of what those provide in proximity to the building. Has that been addressed at all, or any concerns of space availability in trying to make those sort of lessons from that redundancy?
We did look at that, Mark, and I think the question has been, I've been aware that it's there in the community, and people have had some concerns about that. And I talked with staff and got some feedback from staff and spent some time talking with Shari about it. And I think that there, perhaps there was the feeling that there's a duplication of services. But my sense is from staff feedback, the usage of the Pond Cove, that there isn't, that isn't something that really we can look at doing away with. It's a very, very important part of the teacher's work. I think Shari mentioned that there's somewhere between 2,500 and 3,000. One of these books checked out a month. I was very surprised at that number. And the books and so forth, that the materials in there are very much integrated into the teacher's work. And I think also as far as the services that are offered in the media center are something that are really could not be duplicated as they are now. I know that there are probably duplicate kinds of books and so forth, but as far as services are concerned, space is concerned, I don't think it could be duplicated.
So I agree that the services wouldn't be some from each side, but during the day is the library, the town's library, used significantly by children? That space is accessed routinely?
It's used about twice a month, I think, by each team, for each class. Sure. I believe it's monthly or maybe twice a month.
Sue Welch is taking that as part of her assignment to work real closely with Lisa and the Constable and the library. And this has been an ongoing kind of project or undertaking, if you would. The various grade levels access that library very, very frequently. And almost any given time during the day, there is a classroom of students over there. 3 years ago, actually, we were contacted by the library and asked specifically if fourth grade wasn't using the library very much, and worked out a schedule with them, but found that the circulation, that the numbers of students going through there when fourth grade is plugged into that in conjunction, in addition to the K-3 students, that it was really overwhelming for the children to there at the library. There were just so many children coming through there checking out so many books that we had to step back and work with Louise really closely and monitor the numbers of kids that were going over, the selections that they were making. What was happening is our youngsters were going over there if they were working on a research project and literally wiping the shelves clean. For example, if they were doing volcanoes, there would not be a V book to be had in that library for, you know, whatever the time circulation. So I think in terms of your question, yes, it's used very, very, very much. Susan Walsh is here this evening. I know she could speak to that if you really would like to investigate.
Downsizing a section essentially adds 3 students to every class.
Yes.
Or approximately. I mean, these are fractions here, so I'm just saying approximately. Okay.
The next portion of the instructional account is concerned with educational development. And what we hope to do in 3 areas, first of all, in math, there will be 35 teachers who receive training in the University of Chicago math. There would be computer training for grades 3, 4, and 5 teachers. This would enable 17 teachers to better utilize the computers that are already in the classrooms. And then finally, as evidenced by some of the goals of the Language Arts Subcommittee, there's a critical need to establish clear grade level expectations in reading and also repertoire successful strategies to help students to meet these expectations. So So what we're hoping is that 30 K through 3 teachers and special education teachers could be involved in 3 half-day training sessions. This is our hopes for the education and development account. The field trip account.
I have a question on
yes.
that. Have you broken that down by cost yes. for those 3 areas?
The math is amounts to $8,650. The computer would be $2,920, and the reading would be
$9,810. Okay. When would this training take place during the year, or
this is hopefully for the summer.
What are the grade levels for math, for the math program?
Math would be K through 5.
They're all going to be going on the University of Chicago test?
There will be training, initial training, this summer.
And the test will be in place next year?
Not in all cases. In some cases, if they aren't even available.
Okay, so what's the purpose of the training then? Are there some things that are being done in that program that can be used in the classroom now, even without the text?
There are already.
Pardon me?
I'm
sorry.
For the grade levels that aren't going to have the University of Chicago text next year, what's the purpose of training them now?
The plan is, we've spoken with Michael Effner and Gary Record, is to offer the workshop training for the K-3 teachers very intensely throughout the summer. Beginning on March 18th, the early release workshop, and going throughout the spring, Gary and Michael work very closely with teachers to support them to spend time in looking at ways that we can incorporate and extend the study guides and the resource guides that have been developed over the last 2 years through the summer work to, in essence, pull things together for the fall, to offer teachers in a K-3 the opportunity to jump on board, to be in full Chicago work if it's and as I said, to offer that to many teachers. There are teachers who, right at the moment, I see people looking at the clock, embraced the Chicago series at this point. Kindergarten, first grade to some degree. And Gary seems to feel that some of the third grade teachers are ready for to really launch into Chicago for the fall. 4 and 5 pieces are not published, will not be published. Hopefully, the third grade piece will be published by August this year. Teachers will have some time to work with the series to begin to implement it in classrooms, hopefully, in the fall. And the intent is, with the summer work for the 4th and 5th grade teachers, is to offer them opportunities to work closely with the K-3 staff, to be well aware of the Chicago series, because we are using it in our upper grades, the middle school and the high school, so that when their grade level is published, they will have a view of both sides to assist them, because we've had some teachers express concern about in feeling that there's a possibility that some folks feel more strongly about is that there's perhaps gaps in what's happening now in 4th grade, 5th grade. We do have the adults mostly text in place, but then we do have a lot of the resource guides there, but teachers need more time to work with that, to firm up programs and that's important.
So part of this, these workshops, though, will be to focus in on this particular curriculum weaknesses or gaps. Just a quick thing. Who's going to do the computer training? In the system or out of the system?
I don't think that's really been determined yet. There are some folks I think they could do it. Field trip. Field trip account at this point is exactly where it was last year, and that's at zero. And so we need to continue to look to parents for support of these kinds of opportunities. The decrease in the instructional supplies account is due to a $25 reduction in the supplies amount allotted for each teacher. And there's an additional amount that was put in for, I believe this was an amount of $800, for the startup of a new classroom that was to be added at the second grade level. Now, whether or not that, whether or not that occurs, of course, will be decided by the population. But there also, I should add, that there's going to be a need to provide some startup materials for some of the special education needs that will be moved about. In guidance, the cost increases are due to the elimination of the MEAs at the fourth grade level and the fact that the CTB testing, which formerly was called the SRA testing, that is more costly than the SRAs. However, I think I heard recently that the MEAs may be back in because there's an advantage of close to $12 million in math and science. So. What state of Maine decides there. The gifted and talented. We looked at this account and from a systemic point of view, the gifted and talented program at the intermediate level has been, and we've been aware of this for quite some time, is vulnerable to budgetary reductions. And as Connie mentioned the other evening, we still recognize the need to address the 5% gifted and talented population. And at this point, we haven't solved how we're going to be doing that, but we're looking at a variety of ways of staffing that possibilities. Library and media account, there is an increase there. The amount of $1,000 for visiting author program is proposed for this year. And this was encouraged by the parents who view this as a very valuable part of the media program. And in the past, the PCPA has contributed also to providing visiting artists, visiting authors. The amount of $400 is needed to refurbish and to update some quite outdated audiovisual equipment in the intermediate unit. In the computer lab.
I have a question on that.
Yes.
It's specific equipment that's used by the intermediate unit, even though it comes under the library media.
Right.
It's not equipment used by the middle school.
I don't know that for sure.
Well, I think what Hayden did there is he split his budget. He took the 4-8 budget, and then the things that he thought would be more directed towards 4-5 was placed in the elementary budget, and the other ones are in the 6-8 budget.
That's probably answers my question also. The salary and aides line for the elementary school is drastically higher than at the other two schools. Is some of that split with the middle school, the library, because the intermediate unit uses the library in the middle school, and some of that?
I believe that's the case. I do have it.
That is true. I've asked that.
They are shared. This doesn't sound like a deed.
That's just the way that the people are split into different 5, 6, 8.
Okay, so that's not just the, that includes, so some of that's in the actual middle school media center. I just have one comment about the visiting author program. The surveys we've done and the input that the PCPA has gotten on that issue is that that isn't really the highest priority, and I would like to see more parent discussion on whether that's something that we really want to have.
I think that's going to be appropriate for the agenda. Computer lab. There were last year in the springtime several computers added, and curriculum materials for Voyage of the Mimi in the intermediate unit. And the previous account was in the neighborhood of $100, which really isn't a great deal. So we've added in a $900 amount there for software and computer supplies to help support those computers that were placed there last spring. In language arts.
Just one question. Those are computers in the classroom, right?
Those are computers.
Actually, that money was earmarked for use in the computer lab for instruction for the 303 students that go through that computer program. And it would be nice if we could access them for the computer program, but in the instructional account, I believe there is textbook software to access some of that. This money, in speaking with Randy Perkins today, and he again was appreciative. Beth and I began to look at this line probably 2 months ago, and felt that in keeping with the need to make some move towards upgrading technology, that it did not seem reasonable to be running a computer lab for 303 students and offer a person $100 for supplies for the year for repairs for new software. That when you look at a budget like this, it is hard to remember all those conversations, yes. But that was the conversation we had for that.
How often does 4-5 have computer? Is it like on a 6-day schedule?
Yes, it is, and it's on a shared schedule right now. By semester, students might have it. Say you're in a fourth grade classroom, it flip-flops with art. And students would have either access to more intense instruction for computer and not have an art component at that point, and then the next semester would flip that. So they do get computer throughout the year, but each year we try some approach.
It's like sections and not.
That's right.
Not like
it's in terms
one
of sections.
Days all year.
That's right.
It's very similar to the sixth and seventh grade schedule that I handed you earlier, Charlie. They have that same rotation.
Is there a computer curriculum for 4-5?
Yes. Yes, there is. And I could provide you there as we get to get in touch with that.
So Randy does that.
Randy does do the fourth grade, the intermediate program. I spoke to Randy today about that for next year, for regardless of where fourth grade students are.
In language arts, there are no major program changes that are proposed, although there is the intention to continue grade level assessment and reading. And the staff development, which we talked about earlier, which addresses integrating reading strategies. The language arts coordinator will be part of a reassignment to a regular full-time teaching position. Integrated arts, as I mentioned earlier in the overview, was downsized to grade last year, and again was very vulnerable this year. We put together proposal that I gave each of you just before we began this evening that kind of embodies what it is exactly that, that we're going to be doing with integrated arts. through the coordination of Gretchen Berg, who's been at Pine Cove for quite some time and knows staff and knows children, and also has a strong acquaintance and strong connections with the art community and knows that the folks that are out there will be available and accessible to Pine Cove. Gretchen and I came up with this proposal, basically Gretchen came up with a proposal to utilize the amount that was left in integrated arts. We looked at the other possibility of just simply providing an amount to each of the teams and decided that this would be far more fruitful and far more productive in the fact that it will be integrated. There is a connection. Gretchen will have the time to coordinate that. And she's presented the budget there for you on that sheet.
Presently, Gretchen works a half a year, correct?
Point, I believe it's
but
it,
she
point
works
six.
Full-time for half a year.
Yes.
Correct. How does this impact her time now?
This
as,
proposal?
As kind of a coordinator. Will she be essentially working throughout the year or just a...
Well, I think it will depend on... I think that hasn't been decided yet. I think that that her time will be... Once this is approved, or if it is approved, then we can go from there and decide how that will work with the schedule.
I have one other question back on language arts. Since you're eliminating a coordinator, how do you plan to monitor what is happening in K-5 language arts? Is it going to be like a stipend leadership, you know, like a team leader type of thing, or what?
That's an approach that's been considered. I think that there definitely is a need there to do monitoring. There's a concern about budget, concern about curriculum, and there is, I think, a need to address that in an organized sort of fashion. I would say that not only for language art, but math as well. There certainly is a lot to do.
So you're looking for some kind of a core, some kind of a, similar to like a team leader, but more responsible for?
Mm-hmm. Or parts, perhaps dividing those responsibilities into various people.
One of the other opportunities that arises, as I understand it, with this type of framework is to fold gifted and talented services into those job descriptions.
Into
the K-5, or rather the 4-5, gifted and talented. One of my questions is that with the gifted and talented, with the loss of the gifted and talented position, how are we going to be able to service those children who need those types of services?
I think at this point that hasn't been fully. I think that we recognize that there's a need to do that. I think there's a possibility. Connie and Gretchen and I had a conversation thinking about the possibility that that's something that Gretchen might be able to pick up with her background. How it's going to be accomplished, I don't know. So maybe I'm not answering.
Gretchen Berg picking up the gifted and talented language arts and math.
If I might just pick up on that.
Sure.
We did put some money, I pointed out on Tuesday, under consultants, so there is a $15,000 piece in that line to facilitate some kind of, you know, filling in the blanks there. Two of the specifics that we have actually, I've talked to somebody at USM on philosophy for children, which is very interesting. It's sort of an extension of Great Books, for which we do as really an integrated part of our language arts program. The clear issue here is how to identify, and we do have a gifted and talented program. It is under the umbrella of the special ed department, so it remains both a system responsibility and a special ed responsibility, to either refine that monitoring or to continue to monitor how that happens. The exact nature of the program, which has been under somewhat continual revision for the last 3 years, will be focused on the identified 5%. And this is partly in tune with the fact that we, through curriculum work, are trying to consider how do we upgrade the standards for everybody, or how do we make them clearer, or how do we address those kind of issues. Because part of what the full-time gifted and talented position was looking at was a kind of middle-level enrichment. And that has been a problematic issue with that particular umbrella program. So the $15,000 is in the budget, but in a different line, and it's under consultation, which means that as some of these things become clearer, not so much that Gretchen would be doing gifted and talented, but that as part of some of the outreach to line up a particular strand of consultants, she might, in fact, put us on to something, particularly if we had a gifted and talented strand in the arts and so forth. The program as it's now running at the 4-5 is not an everyday program anymore. So it's going to be something that we will be constructing based on our experience of what's worked. And there may be some, as we put the entire staffing pattern together for K-5 before the end of this school year, there may well be some particular piece of staffing that presents itself as a way of doing it. For instance, at the middle school, when Mary Jo left last year, was one of our regular teachers who picked up a gifted and talented class and so forth. It's that kind of thing that will happen again at the 4-5.
On the indicator, I'm sorry, arts. When I read what Gretchen's job would be, it really seems to me that a lot of these things should be being done through our regular art program. I mean, we have an art program in place. The kids have art once a week anyway. And when I look at these things, I really fail to see why we can't do that within a program, within the regular art program.
I think the art program that Marie deals with is basically concerned with visual arts. And I think what Gretchen is proposing here would perhaps involve visual arts, but other arts as well.
We've gotten an awful lot of feedback through the PCPA and through the community dialogue that people clearly value the arts in this town, but there also are an awful lot of people who think some of these programs could be offered through the community services, or that we could have, there are plenty of talented people in this community who, in fact, several have approached me about coming in and volunteering their time in the classroom. It just seems to me that this is continues to be a really expensive way to get arts education for our kids.
I think I wouldn't dispute that, but I do think that this is, to have this amount of money, I think this is really absolutely the best way to utilize it, because it does offer an opportunity to utilize Gretchen's knowledge of the staff. She's already worked with staff members. She knows the children. She also has a connection with the, as I said before, the artist community. And I think the other possibility of way of using the money would be to allocate it to a particular team, which then places that on the team to coordinate that, locate the artists, and set up the contract and so forth. Whereas here, there's an opportunity for Gretchen to coordinate that, and it seemed to provide the best of all worlds with this amount of money.
Well, I still think we should explore whether we don't have some volunteer talent in the town who would be willing to help coordinate some of these functions. I just think we should explore a little further.
And if I could just also, on behalf of our home staff, I really feel that it's important that we look at the fact that we really have offered and downsized the integrated arts program from 66,000, give or take whatever line you want to look at, in 91, down to 23,000 this year. That's a significant hit for the arts. Something that we value very, very much for our kids. And it would be, I would feel remiss if I didn't speak to it, because probably all the work that has gone into the arts program within the building. And I feel that it would be a travesty if we absolutely don't provide the direction and tap the expertise of Gretchen, or who has the knowledge, the contacts, the talent, to continue, even at this minimal amount, to bring experiences to our children, whether they be through something that she delivers, or through her contacts, through her grant writing, through the opportunities that she can provide our staff, and through the leadership that I believe only she can provide as an artist.
Well, then I guess I don't understand what we're really doing in the music and art programs that we have in place that are separate from this. I just have never been able to understand why this can't be incorporated into those programs.
That's a really very good point, and it's something that Beth and I worked really hard. We really worked this year to try to begin to have the Allied Arts team look at true arts experiences for youngsters, and that perhaps through the budget process it might be something we need to address in terms of what are arts experiences that we value for our children, how can we best define them and pull them together in terms of a full arts experience. Do they need all arts experiences at every grade level? How can we best do that in keeping with state guidelines for curriculum, what's in place for kids? The history of it, as Beth has said, I think it's a tremendous fit to that program that we very much believe in.
Wow.
I just have a question. Could you star that account so we could come back to it? And also, I think it's understated by $2,232.
It's what?
Understated.
By how much?
$2,232. Based on this handout versus this sheet. We don't have to spend a minute on it, but just to check those. Like, I'd hate to have it $2,200 short at the end.
It's funny. I get a different difference.
Well.
But you're on to the same thing I'm on. How do these numbers fit together?
I think what's not there is an amount that was also included for supplies.
Supplies.
Yes.
Supplies is $3,400.
$3,430.
Well, why don't we look at that? Not do the auditing now, but there is a difference.
In regard to the math account, the math coordinator, as well as the language arts coordinator, will be reassigned to a classroom position. And exactly what that position and where that will be at this point, we're not certain. However, as I mentioned before in regard to language arts, there still is very much a vital need to maintain coordination and staff development in math as well as in language arts. Under Office of the Principal,
I'll just make one comment about math, where we're starting to integrate the Chicago program down into the lower grade, and we're starting with educational development training this summer. You know, I think that's one area we should make sure that we really have a good person on board, whether it's a stipend team leader or whatever. I say that's a very critical area if you're really making a drastic change.
Yes, I agree. I think the coordination is critical.
I think we also do need to make Michael Lethnikoff, that his position will still be intact, and he will have opportunities to work with the KP staff.
But he's teaching half time. Has he really been working with the other two coordinators?
Yes.
Okay.
They meet weekly.
Okay.
office of the principal. There are very few changes there. There is one piece of equipment that we would like to add, and that is a computer table. And that's in the K-3 unit, correct?
Is the separate school bus staff at the 4-5, it's at the 4-5 unit now, will that remain the same? With just fifth grade at the middle school, will that office?
I don't think that's been determined yet, to be honest.
Can I address that, ma'am? I think one of the major issues in this whole year of reorganization is determining whether the time to make the break between K-4 and 5-8 is next year, or whether that ought to be phased in during the following year. It's an item that I will certainly be placing on our agenda. We're looking at some of the issues. I think clearly staff will have opinions about it, and have some views of it. I just want to remind people that all of this reorganization is frankly only laying the groundwork for the building plans that we have. And even though we're not able to get started on those building plans, I'm working right now on the state proposal for the middle school, and in which has to go in by April 15th. And as far as Pond Cove goes, the Pond Cove reorganization or the Pond Cove renovation and special space addition, which would be largely the gym, will be going in October. Those are state mandated dates. There's nothing I can do, and I'm not intending to imply that the middle school takes precedence over Pine Cove. The middle school is what the state classifies as a major project. The Pine Cove project is what the state classifies as a special project, and those are the dates that they mandate for the submission of those projects. So that is, in fact, something very much ongoing. As we get tied to this year's budget with this year's problems, it's easy to forget that this is only starting a process which is going to yield far better buildings, far better space, far better program space, K-8. So as we go through some of these kinds of discussions about do we make some kind of formal break, administratively speaking, where do we house, instead we're going to need the Secretary of Support. Exactly where and how that will be, I mean, I think we're not the place to put them, so they'll be where they are. The exact definition of their duties and so on will be obviously fine-tuning, and we'll come back to you with a specific. But I don't see that as a budgetary issue at the moment. I think we will need their support wherever they are, exactly however they're concerned.
Under the Office of Principal, I have a cause that's called equity. Under dues and fees, the elementary is going down $1,000, the middle school is going up $1,000, and the high school went up $251. Can you explain why your dues and fees are going down, and the middle school is going up substantially, and the high school a little bit?
She can explain it first.
I guess that's a question to the other two principals.
I'll be quiet then.
Can you explain why yours are going down?
That amount was, I'm not certain, I honestly don't know what the other principals' amounts were. We just simply looked at the fact that there's a need to reduce the budget, and that was $1,500 is a substantial amount. We thought $500 was. I really don't know what the other, what the other.
So what kind of dues or fees or organizations would you not be?
There's some national, Nancy and I talked about, there's some national organizations which really, for us, really don't carry that many benefits, other than a few publications. And basically, I think at one point, was that the consortium?
No,
right. There was an amount that that was, I think it was perhaps in the area of $1,000. It was for consortium issues.
Nancy can address her. Okay. Since hers is going up $1,000, yours is going down.
Yeah, but it's a great explanation,
Charlie. It's probably a trade. Somebody got a price on it without $751.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Improvement of instruction, there is, this is another area where there's been reduced $1,000. This is from travel and council, travel and conferences account. And this again was done in the recognition of the need for budgetary restraint. Special education, there's a 35% reduction in this account, and that is attributable in large degree to a reconfiguration of programming and the movement of particular special ed students to the middle school budget, and then also involving the return of the Cape Elizabeth, to Cape Elizabeth, and out of district placement. So that's reduced that considerably.
Is the increase in the teacher assistant just from those two assistants? This is really to do with the two assistants we just,
that actually turned last year. One of the high school teacher assistants was reassigned to the K-5, but not reflected in the budget year we thought it was.
And then finally, under co-curricular, and I just simply want to restate this again, and it was stated, I believe, in last year's presentation, that we hope that there will be equity as far as the stipends are concerned, equity between and amongst Conco, the middle school, and the high school for the teacher leaders. And I think that some of that may well come out of the joint study committee's accomplishments. Operation and maintenance of plant. There was a reduction in that area. This is a portable structure upkeep, and I'm not entirely certain what that amounted to, but I'm just hoping that the upkeep continues. you know, that amount's been removed, along with the rest of the upkeep as far as Pine Cove is concerned. And I also wanted to add at this point that we've been very happy to have custodial services during the daytime, which Palm Cove apparently has not had before, and it really has contributed a lot, I think, to know that there is a custodian there and present, and to address the various and sundry custodial kinds of issues that come up during the day.
And I just want to point out that was not an additional staff person. That was one of our first reorganizational quality moves to sort out some certain assignments. I just want to make a point that didn't cost anything.
Right.
I'm going to take it back to general instruction. Under salaries, teachers' assistants, I see an increase from $10,986 to $40,282. And I don't see that reflected in your cover letter. It's under Pond Cove General Instruction 8700-1112. Now, we did approve teacher assistance this year to handle a problem of oversized classes. But I understood that that was a temporary measure and we were not going to carry that over. It would be rethought at the budget.
Well, it's our recommendation that they remain. Now, I thought that was part of the general discussion on some of the potential increases or difficulties at the first and second grade. It also has been internally a discussion that, and if we didn't actually surface it here, Mayor Copel, let's do that right now. I strongly recommend that we keep those two teacher assistants for general purpose assistance, if you will. The only assistants that we've been hearing regularly at the K-5, for the most part, with some exceptions, have been in the special education strand. Frequently, we have to add, sometimes just for a short period of time, sometimes for a full year, because of particular student needs. I think I had some conversation with the board last year when a need came up or a proposal came up for
teacher assistants, and we were also talking about making some changes, proposing in our discussion about calendar, some reduction, change in the way we think about staff development time during the school year, reduction in released afternoon workshops. There's no way the primary teacher schedules can do all of these things if we don't have some kind of paraprofessional strand. We also have some concerns about how are we going to implement a different kind, or at least an upgrade of the math program. We are looking hard at the reading program. We have a number of issues, some of which are identified, but some of which we assume that we'll understand better as we go along. All of them point to both a combined need of staff development and an additional way of getting one-on-one instruction to children, not necessarily through a special ed strand. We want to be more inventive, perhaps, is a way of putting it, but teachers need support. So on my cover sheet, probably, now that I think about it, Truth in Lending should have focused on the addition of the two teacher assistants. It's actually a continuation of the budget as far as that goes, the ones we added. I think they're working well, and I think that concept is one that has been not present at Concove, and I would strongly support it.
Well, standard rains without them blowing up. But now that we've learned so much, it's just made extra space, and now I think the capacity of our brains is infinite. And Mrs. Bell doesn't only just teach us how to do these math problems, she does it in such a way that we just don't forget it. It just stays in there, drills in. All the students in language arts, we compare our ideas to come up with solutions for future problem solving, which is what we're doing currently, and we are doing pretty well in that. Last year in Mrs. Bell Language Arts, our topic was Shakespeare, and that was really intriguing, I thought, because I don't think we'll ever get a chance to do anything like that again. We had the chance to perform The Tempest, which is one of Shakespeare's plays, on videotape with costumes and props. It was really pretty entertaining to put together. I believe that it would be a real loss to the school system if we couldn't, and others after us, couldn't have the pleasure of working and learning with Mrs. Bell.
Thank you, Jeremy. Any questions?
Since we revisited Gifted and Talented, how many kids are being serviced by that particular program?
Well, the numbers have gone up since December. They were, for a variety of reasons, rather sparse, but
They vary from which grade level, which strand, and in order to attempt to provide a working schedule, some classes might be, I think in this classes of 4 or 5 children, might go anywhere up to 16 children at average instruction.
So that's out of approximately almost 300 students?
303 students.
Any other questions?
My name is Sharon Howard, and I'm moving to...
Would you mind coming up here where we can...
I'm
well, we all are. But, you get used to it after a while.
I just have hard act to follow. This gentleman was very eloquent. I think I
that was a hard act to follow.
Yes. Well, I'm Charlotte Howard, and my son this year is in fourth grade. He's in Gifted and Talented. And I'm very concerned, of course, about the Gifted and Talented program. What I'd like to ask is if there would be any problem as far as having some of the parents of the children involved meet so that they can discuss what they would like to see happen with the program. We realize there's a budget problem, and we realize there's changes that have to be made, but we still can't have our children forgotten. That's all I have to say.
Thank you. That is, both of you, a very powerful testimony. And we do have a budget problem. It's an agonizing one. Are there any Further questions? Any further comments from the board?
I think you asked that question. Is there a forum which they can meet with some appropriate administrator?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
How would that be best done?
I would thank the administration, but also, as I said, this is under, technically under the umbrella of gifted and talented, special education. I'm sure Shirley could initiate something like that.
Okay, shall we move on to the middle school? Nancy? Thank you, Beth. Thank you, Nancy.
I want to make one comment. Under Mary Jo's auspices, she acquired a good many grants for us. And I hope that we're able to continue that in some way. I mean, that brings a lot of developmental type of programming.
Anyone in the audience would like, we do have two handouts that the board already has, that if you would like to look at these, make available to you. Well, one of the disadvantages of going last is I have little notes all over my presentation about previous questions that have come up that we can perhaps answer.
And you only have 7.5 minutes.
That's right, but it's there. If you have any questions, just let us know. First of all, a couple of things. I also would like to thank the entire middle school staff and faculty for a very superb job in putting together the budget. We came together with the idea of coming in with zero-based increases, even realizing that we knew we would be going up 60 students. And we say 60 students based on people who are actually here now. Historically, we have not had the increase over the summer that the elementary school has. And I think the last 2 years, we've averaged about 10 students per year. So we're going to go on that historical fact and think that maybe we'll only have an increase of 10. As you look through the overview that I gave you the other night, our class sizes are up to 22 and 23, especially in grades 6 and 7. If we received a large number of 6th graders coming in or 7th graders coming in, we would have to come back to the board for further guidance on that. But we do feel that based on the last few years, we should be able to handle that increase. Before I go any further, I'd like to introduce Phil Jewett, who is our instructional assistant. Last year after our presentation, several people called up to talk to us about the presentation, and one of the most frequent questions was, who is that gentleman sitting beside you? So I'd like to clear that up.
You're a very recent arrival on the scene, aren't you, Phil? Sure.
Sure. as we go through the budget, try to follow down through somewhat the overview that I gave you, although we tried to cover several different things in that overview. We'll try to go down through the accounts as they are listed in the budget. First of all, a little history for ourselves. Last year, part of our work in the budget was to reduce the time that students spent in our allied arts areas. And we reduced those positions from some of them from full-time offerings to 6/10 offerings. Then we shared those people this year with grades 4 and 5 so that indeed the personnel were working full-time. But actually, students were spending less time. One of the programs that has greatly affected is our computer program, where it's 8th graders now. This year, our current 8th graders have spent approximately half, a little bit less than half the time that they spent the previous year in computer instruction. And that has affected how much they have been able to cover. We were prepared for that. We talked about that with the high school last year. They knew that was coming, and that's part of what you heard in Frank's presentation the other night, that with the incoming freshman class, they would need to pick up more of that computer instruction. My understanding from Mr. Watson, talking with him more thoroughly on Wednesday after Tuesday night's presentation, is that one of the things they have found that they can spend less time on is the keyboarding. And that is why some of that has come through in Frank's budget in doing that. But I did hand out to you an overview of what the computer curriculum is in grades 6, 7, and 8. Marie developed for us and gave to me today to hand out to you. So if you have any questions on that, I'd be glad to try to answer those. Charlie.
How old is this curriculum?
This curriculum originally was the one that was developed back when we first put computers into the middle school and added it to our instructional program. I would say it's at least 5 years old. The revision that you have in front of you is a revision that Marty did this year based on having less time with the students in 8th grade. The time for 7th graders and 6th graders did not change that much. In fact, there was no time change for 6th grade computer instruction. 7th grade computer instruction went down a bit. There was a real reduction in the 8th grade program. So this is a revised, what he did, the former 8th grade program would have been to really work to take the proficiency test that was determined. And they would practice every couple of days taking that test and passing. They don't do that this year. He said that at any time you could test the students for proficiency, but they haven't practiced to take that test. That's something that he's left out. And also, the other thing that used to be in all of the programs was keyboarding and a review of keyboarding and more proficiency development in keyboarding. And that they work on that, but it does not receive the emphasis that it received in the past. So it's a 5-year-old curriculum that has been revised, but it has not had a major revision or major curriculum review, which I think we are now in a position to do as we establish a vision for what we want for computer education in Cape Elizabeth.
Sometime before they graduate by their 12th year, they have to take that proficiency test.
That is correct.
State requirement.
That is correct. And the high school knows that with this incoming freshman class, that will need to be done in the high school. In the past, it has been met by the high majority of students in the middle school.
Actually, I'm glad to see that happened because of budgetary constraints, because I think that's put an additional pressure on those 8th graders that there was one more thing that they had to accomplish before they get out of 8th grade. Mm-hmm. And sometimes typing is not one of the things that 6th or 7th or 8th grader mm-hmm. wants to sit down and practice.
I'm just wondering how, if you don't know keyboarding, you do the word processing, writing process.
They do keyboarding. They do introductions to keyboarding. What they don't spend is the amount of time practicing that they did before they go right into then moving on to the program. But having been in the computer classes a couple of times myself and doing things, they actually are practicing it. You don't see a lot of two-finger computer punching. That you see with me in my office, but you don't see too many other people in the middle school operating that way.
And I believe it's, isn't it 30 to 35 words per minute that they have to type?
Actually, the old test, I believe, was 20 words per minute with less than 2 errors. Mm-hmm. Okay, we also, as we began to look at our general instruction and realizing we're having an increase of students, we asked for an increase of 2 positions. Originally, this increase would have been in grades 6 and 8, where we are anticipating an increase in enrollment. Recently, we have worked through some scheduling procedures and some staffing procedures in-house, and Mr. Jewett will be transferring back to the 8th grade. So therefore, our positions, our new positions, are actually in grade 6 and grade 7 right now. We will be replacing two of our teachers who will be leaving us due to retirement. One of those the board has already acted on, and one of those I believe will be acting on at your next meeting. So we will have those new positions as well. But those are replacement positions. The other two, the 6th and 7th grade, would be actually our additional positions. But I wanted to clarify for the public right now that it's, when we planned our budget, it was grade 6 and 8. Right now, it would appear to be grade 6 and 7, because Mr. Jewett will be transferring to the 8th grade.
Right now, you have a 6th grade teaming approach, and I see that you're now looking at the same three teams of two, and one self-contained. Mm-hmm. Are we going to look for a new self-contained teacher, or is there someone from
actually,
the system?
Actually, I know of at least two teachers on our present 6th grade team who are interested in doing that self-contained classroom. The 6th grade team is also working that out. Right now, that's our best estimate as to what they're going to do. They're also looking at, is there a way to have three classrooms work together in some kind of fashion so that somebody doesn't get left out of a routine? So they're working on that, and the team will help us decide how to do that. But I wanted to give you some type of a picture of what it looks like right now at this point. But the self-contained, I would say, at this point is going to come, if that's the way we go, will be one of our present 6th grade teachers, so that the new staff person would be working with an experienced 6th grade teacher. Yes, Rosemary.
Nancy, on that same page, with a new two new teachers, possibly four new individuals, and 23 and 4 kids in the 7th grade and a self-contained classroom, is there still going to be common planning time?
No. There will not be common planning time for our 6th grade teachers. There will perhaps not be common planning time for our 7th grade teachers due to the fact that the recommendation is to cut our life skills and health program. And I have asked the 7th grade team to look at offering something for a small group of students, 12 to 15 students each day, to work on something. And they are working on some things we're talking about already at this point are a study skills lab and maybe some sustained silent reading or a way to extend the language arts classes, which also received a reduction in time. So they will not have common planning time. The 8th grade team doesn't actually end up with common planning time either because they have so many shared staff that this year, for instance, our 8th grade has one time in the week when everybody can be there, and it's an after-school meeting. And that's because they have people who work at the high school on their faculty, people who work part-time, and people who work in other grade levels. One of our current 8th grade teachers teaches 4 8th grade math classes and 1 7th grade language arts class. So that has taken care of some of the common planning time.
Is there anything that we can do within the budget that would allow common planning time, or has that been determined not to be essential to middle school?
Oh, no, we would still say it's essential to middle school. What it's in conflict with is what can we afford. One of the things that has allowed us common planning time is having the students need to be involved in some type of activity. And one of the things that has helped us with that is our allied arts offerings. As we reduce those allied art offerings, we are going to reduce the possibility for common planning time. With 6 classes in a grade level, having a 6-day rotation works fairly well for everybody to be someplace. When you go with 7 classrooms at a grade level, then the problem is you either go to a 7-day rotation, which is really a long time in between those classes you have once every 7 days, because that's once every 7 school days. And the Allied Arts team felt that was really too long a gap to see different students, so they preferred the 6-day rotation to anything further than that, anything longer than that. So it means that there isn't common planning time for anybody who's on our 6-day rotation. That would be grades 4 and 5, as well as grade 6. Grade 7 is impacted more by the reduction of the life skills program than the fact that, because there are just 6 groups of students.
Added study skills or whatever group you're talking about. find out, is that in addition to these academic tutorials that you have that next month?
And it hasn't been determined what they're going to do. I asked the seventh grade team the other day to look at, was there something that they could offer that would have purpose to it, some real structure to it, that they could offer for small groups of students that they would see once every 6 days. And they might do this in group sex. Somebody might take it for 5 weeks and teach a unit on something. Someone might take it for 5 other weeks and teach a unit on something. They're still working that out. It's a problem that the team has to come together and help us solve because it's brought to us by the fact that we do not have the life skills program for them to go to.
I have to admit I have a little bit of a problem with the idea of trying to scramble to find something for kids to do so teachers can have that planning time. Of trying to make something up that'll fit
well,
that space.
It's not exactly quite that way, and I may be misrepresenting it. What happens is that the students are not necessarily divided out into homeroom groups. In fact, next year we may divide them out by looking at different musical instruments that they play. And the reason is right now sectionals, their lessons that they take, come out of academic time. We would like to put that program into our allied arts schedule so it does not come out of the other academic subject time for the seventh graders. We figured out a way to do that for sixth graders. The seventh grade has not had music as an offering for the last several years. There has not been a general music program for the seventh graders. When we do that, you don't necessarily end up with your math class or with your language arts class or with your social studies class. You may end up with students from several different groups. So to say that, gee, I could just have an extra language arts class today is going to be difficult if the teachers aren't coordinated together to think of something together to offer during that time. And that's why we're looking at the team to come up with something for that. Because all the other seventh graders will be off into some other event. Also, in our staffing, as we went through, we had originally requested a 0.5 remedial position for language arts and mathematics. The teams went through and just began to identify numbers of students that they felt could access this program. We had approximately 60 students who we felt could access the program, with more 6th and 7th graders accessing the language arts program, more 7th and 8th graders accessing the math program, and that had to do with the fact that as you go up through and more transition math, for instance, in our 8th grade, this year you either take transition math, algebra, or geometry. And if you're not quite ready to take transition math, then we have to scramble around in a way to figure out a math program for you and to find an instructor, because all the instructors are taken up with our other math programs. So we felt that it was a position that we needed. However, after reviewing all of the things very carefully, it's the superintendent's recommendation that that's a position we can't afford right now. We were also asked, is there something else we could give up for that position? And we felt it would have to come out of some of our other academic programming, and we needed all of those positions as well. So that's what we are trying to do there is, once again, the team's coming together to look at other ways to meet that need, and we may do it by ways that instead of some students going to advisor advisee, that perhaps they'll go to a math lab to work during that time with one of our math teachers. We have a seventh grade math teacher who would like to look at that. We need to develop it more and come with a more solid idea and presentation to you than I have for you tonight. But it's one of the things that we're looking at to still meet that need. This may also be a way to meet the need of some of our students that we feel need a little bit more language arts time, and perhaps using some of that extra time from the Allied Arts Squad to meet that will be a way to address the issue there.
This is remedial help.
Yes. This is not special education help. These are all students.
It's not help for giftedness.
No. This was remedial help. We do not have a remedial program in the middle school. So if you do not qualify for special services, then the classroom teacher is responsible for trying to find as much time and to modify the program as best he or she can to meet the needs of those students. The other, yes.
How many kids are this?
We came up with 60 students.
60. Mm-hmm.
Now, 60 not all, remedial students. Not all of those students would access the program. 60 students that teachers felt could use some extra assistance in either of those programs. Yes.
Do you have that broken down by grade approximately?
Yes, I do, on another sheet of paper that I can get to later.
Considering the report that we got on the language, I mean, the language arts program, and I'm just wondering how many of those were sixth graders, how many were seventh graders.
We can try to find out when we come back here. Another increase in our general instruction account is a request to increase our aid to 30 hours per week from up from 25. This past year, we have downsized the secretarial positions in the middle school from 2 full-time secretaries in the principal's office to 1.5. And there have been some concerns with that. The instructional aid has helped cover the office some. Our office is very busy towards the latter part of the day. Our phone rings almost constantly. So that's almost a full-time job for someone just answering the phone. And then also with the increase of students coming in, the teachers need more assistance in getting classroom materials prepared and ready for the next day. Also in our industrial technology classes, when they are over 18, we need to have another person in those classes for safety precautions. We try to have no more than 22, but we do have some classes of 22 in there. And and the instructional aide goes in and assists in that class. Right now, she is not in there because our industrial technology teacher has a student teacher. And so this has freed our instructional aide up to help in other classes a little bit more. But that was the reason for that request. The remedial breaks down to in the sixth grade, there were about 6 students that would need language arts assistance and 7 who would need math assistance. I got those numbers from Mary Bruns, who currently works in that program in the fifth grade. So there may be some other students, but those are her actual figures that she
so
works
with. So these are the fifth graders going into sixth?
Right. This would be incoming sixth graders. Incoming seventh graders, there were 12 students they felt needed the assistance in language arts and 17 in math. And incoming 8th graders, 8 in math, and 10 in language arts. On our educational development, program, which is down a little bit, but that does involve 1 day of summer work for each grade level team, and 1 week of math work for our math teachers, working with Charlotte Hanna for that week, and that is to continue work on our curriculum development, our assessment packages, assessing how the transition math program is going, how that is impacting our instruction in all of our grade levels. Next year, we anticipate that we may have 1 or 2 transition math classes in the sixth grade. This year, we have 1. We're anticipating that we could have up to 3 transition math classes in the seventh grade. This year, we have 2. And we are also there will be a full algebra class in the seventh grade. In the past 2 years, seventh graders have been able to access eighth grade algebra classes, but we have 19 students who will be in algebra next year in the seventh grade, and that will be a class unto themselves. So we need to begin to see how all of that works together, and that's what that summer work is for. And the other money in there is for to continue our work with our language arts assessment, which has been matching money for us this year with a grant from the Southern Maine Partnership. We will be applying for a grant with them again to see if we can get some matching funds, and that's for our reading and writing connection assessments that we're doing in the spring and the fall of each year. Our field trips is an interesting account. It's interesting at this point. It's up $250 because of the seventh grade trip to Boston and realizing they need to take 3 buses instead of 2. With close to 140 students in the class. But it's all transportation. The students bring their own money for entry fees and things. The interesting part of that account is when I check, it hasn't we haven't been charged with any of the transportation, although we have to be charged for it. So I don't know if that is something that will come to us at the end of the year or not, but I just checked again, and our money that we planned on this year spending, the $1,500, is still there. So, but it is all transportation, and I don't know. I just find that interesting. Yes?
For those of us who don't have kids at that level, what's the trip to Boston?
Okay, the trip to Boston is the Boston Museum of Science trip, and it's a trip that when students come back, they always say, even students who have been to the Boston Museum of Science, their comment is, I've been to the Boston Museum of Science before, but never like that. And the teachers go down and do a tremendous amount of work beforehand, and there are different programs and stations that they go through and activities that they have to do, and it is a very involved day. It is the collective opinion of our seventh grade team that that is the valuable trip. That is the only field trip that the seventh grade takes. The field trip money breaks down to $250 for the sixth grade, and they mostly go on local trips. That's some of the marsh work that they do, and also just to some of the local things in town. The seventh grade trip was budgeted at $750. The eighth grade came in with a request for $800, and that is for trips to the New Orleans, which is part of their main unit, trips to the State House in Augusta, which is part of the unit that they do in social studies, a trip to the Brunswick Theater for Shakespeare, which is part of their Shakespeare unit that they do in language arts, and also their end of the year trip to Old Orchard Beach, and a trip that they do sometimes in the winter for a winter break trip. All of the monies, I think the mileage was done at $2 per mile, and it was done with the assistance of Charlie Freeman, our transportation director, helped people come up with those amounts. But it is all transportation. Yes, Charlie?
Have you ever asked the student, because I think seventh and eighth graders, especially sixth graders, have you ever asked them to assess what they felt about some of these trips?
Especially in the Boston Museum of Science trip that we have, because many times parents fairly have asked us, gee, our kids have been to the Boston Museum of Science, do they need to go again? And in our parents' newsletter, I think they have written notes about what they gained from the trip. Sometimes it's, I'm not sure if it's been in the parents' newsletter or the kids' courier, but the seventh grade teachers have done that. The New Orleans trip this year, I know the eighth grade team is reassessing that because some of the students had been before and looking at that, so they are looking very carefully at it. We will not go on a trip just to go on a trip. And people have, we've really asked them to use the guideline to make sure that there's a real purpose and that when people get back, they felt that that purpose was met.
I didn't want to name specifics, but you mentioned the one that I heard a lot of comment about. And I'm wondering, do you ever get student feedback on some of them?
They do, and I think, Hope, the eighth graders this time, did they assess the New Orleans trip, or did they, was it just part of the...
Are you asking whether they assessed the
students? The benefit.
Whether we assess the students?
Well, I know you assessed the students.
yes, we did an assessment. And this year, because there have been students who have treated that trip as if it were not part of the curriculum, we provided an alternate assignment for the research to do, which covered the topics which the trip covers, and the students are quiz when they come back. There's a quiz on the material that they learned while they were away, as well as there are various kinds of assessments of other parts of the curriculum. But as to ask surveying students whether they liked the trip or not, they have not done that.
Have you ever looked into having the Parents Association at the middle school fund some of these field trips? Because I feel I have to note in all fairness that Pond Cove cut out their field trip budget altogether.
Well, I don't think they went to as many places far away as we did. The Parents Association has funded it the last 2 years, has helped us fund a band trip to attend Nelms, and they have helped match. Nelms has contributed to that. That's the New England League of Middle Schools, and our band was invited last spring and also this fall to play at different conferences, and they sent us contributions toward transportation. The Parents Association met the additional costs for those transportation trips. So they have done that. Our Parents Association is building up its treasury. They have been very supportive of our programs, and I think they do not have the substantial amount of money that the Pond Cove Parents Association does, but they are certainly an association that we enjoy working with, and they've been very supportive, so I'm sure they will continue to be, but I don't believe they are in a position to fund all of our field trips.
Okay.
Rosemary. I just have to make a comment about the fundraising of the Middle School Parents Association. There are only 370 families involved in the middle school, the current middle school's current population, so that is always a factor. But the field trips that I'm aware of in the middle school, I think it's important to note, are 10-hour trips and are not a 6.5-hour trip. And I think that that's important to note. When we add up the 3 hours in the bus and subtract it from 6.5, you might want to question the value of a 3.5-hour trip in the museum. But I do think it's longer than that, and the kids leave at 7 or 7:15 in the morning and get back at 5:30, I think. So it's not just the school day.
That's right. In the New Orleans trip, they got back later as well, too. And certainly any of the band trips we've taken have been early departures from school.
Yeah, Nancy, I'm a little concerned. We're on line 9.
Yes.
Quite a few more pages to go. How are we? Are we going to go
we're,
down?
We're moving right along here, Peter. We're just.
Okay.
We got it.
Seems like
because
a
some of the other, I'm not going to go through all the supply things. Those were where our basic changes were, and I was just looking at the basic changes. The other ones are pretty self-explanatory, but I'll be glad to explain them. Textbooks are up due to our increased enrollment and also buying more of our University of Chicago textbooks. That has been an extremely successful program for us, and we certainly want to continue working with that program. And our equipment account is up. Part of that is because we are requesting 2 computers for our special education classrooms. Many of those students use the computers a lot for word processing. Right now, we only have one for one of our.
What's
one of our
computers?
They're Macs. Looking at Macs. For now.
Now, for that, some of the Apple IIs would not be adequate.
If we had enough Apple IIs, what's happening with our Apple IIs is that as they break down and some of the parts are more difficult to get, Mr. Weiss cannibalizes them, I believe the word is the term that he uses, and is using those. So we don't actually have a lot of extra Apple IIs that aren't being used. He's using all the ones that he can, either in the instructional lab, but then we have the work lab as well, too, that has hopefully as many as 16 running computers. Sometimes it's 14 computers.
Well, we asked the high school, but we dealt with it on a district-wide basis, to come up with a 5-year plan for integration and acquisition of computers. And one of the possibilities might be to move the Apple IIs farther down the system into the elementary school, into the middle school. And so I just wanted to reiterate, and I'm not the only board member or member of the public that's touched on this, but we're going to do that as part of this budget process.
I will have a report for you as part of this budget process in 2 weeks, Peter. But we will, in fact, I mean, I think we had a pretty good sense of direction here in the evening.
I make one request of the superintendent, that by the time we get to the system-wide budget meeting, can you total the total number of computers that we're being requested to purchase
there
next year?
Yeah.
You know, we're suddenly getting 2 here and 20 here and 2 here and 3 here, and I think we need to look at the total picture.
Oh, absolutely.
And I would say too that even though the computers are in our special education classrooms, students at those grade levels, other students come in and use those and use that room as well too. And the reason we went with Macs is that we felt we needed to have something that had the capacity to do the kinds of things that these students would want to ask it to do as far as developing reports, learning how to use them, and producing the best material that they could. But they won't be accessed just by special education students. They will be, and we have other students coming into that particular room and using them.
No, I'm not questioning the usage. I'm questioning,
is there a plan?
This has to be part of a grant plan, and there are, I use both Mac and 2, and so I know a lot about the differences between them, and in some cases, a DC-3, if you will, is perfectly adequate. In other cases, it isn't, but I'm beating a dead horse. In 2 weeks, we'll address this subject.
But we'll address part of it next week.
The
next part that I wanted to address, but I was going to jump over to Office of the Principal and talk about the dues and fees thing. But if somebody has a question along the way, please feel free.
I have one on life skills. The $1,500 that remain in the supplies account, is that what you're estimating would be covered under the health part of her curriculum? It's under your general instruction.
Right. Some of it would have, we'd have to look at that very carefully, Charlie, and see which part of that. I don't think we'd need all of the $1,500, but we might need some of that for some of the things we've talked with. As I mentioned in the overview, the physical education teachers are excited about picking up part of that, especially first aid sections and parts on nutrition, and adding to their wellness program. And then other parts that we would need to look at is perhaps going towards some information and materials on AIDS education that may be picked up in part of the seventh grade science curriculum and perhaps the eighth grade advisor advisee program. The health committee still needs to look at that and make recommendations. I don't think we need the entire $1,500.
I hope that the health committee is going to start picking up momentum in developing a curriculum. And I hope that they're also starting to integrate some of this both up and below.
Actually, we've been working for a year and a half now on that, and we've worked on checking what our curriculum is. This year we've worked on connecting with the elementary school and the high school. So we have a pretty good point about that. And now we need to stop for a moment and think, okay, what about the components of the life skills and health program? Because we aren't going to be able to replace, to duplicate all of them. Some of them will be lost, but which are the ones that we should add and make sure that we add to other curriculums in our school? This was an attempt on our part with the dues to combine several accounts that, quite frankly, when Earlene Jackson and I went through this, we kept wondering, why do we have all of these different dues and fees accounts? We had one that was in the Office of the Principal under 2810, and then we had another one that was under Improvement of Instruction, 1810. And you'll notice what we did is we closed out the 1810 account, and we've combined that with the 2810 account, plus added some extra in there for increases. And these are dues for part of our CCC conference money, especially the mathematics program and the math meets that we participate in, also our science fair program and our music festival program. And actually, the music program is quite expensive because they have to buy the music and buying the rights to the music, and that can be an expensive undertaking. Also included in that are, in the past, sometimes our students in Challenge have participated in the Knowledge Bowl, which is a fee, and also our memberships to things like MASCD, which is the Maine Association of Supervision and Curriculum Development, the Maine Associate Middle School League, we belong to the New England League of Middle Schools, and the National Middle Schools Association. So that's what those fees are. We also have, the other place you'll find us paying some CCC fee dues are in athletics. And that has gone up. That's the 2810 account out of 8845. Last year it was 500. This year it's going up to 900. Part of that is to take care of, it's belonging to the indoor track league. And we also added some of that cost, maybe met out of Office of the Principal. What we've done is the athletic, it's always an estimate about what we have to do, and sometimes it depends upon where the cross-country meet is held, how much we have to contribute to that, and what the other fees are, so that's what that is.
Under that indoor track, we have 55 to 60 kids coming out for that.
That is correct.
Is that going to be manageable by two coaches?
So far, they feel that it is. So far, they feel it is. I know what Ray Cooper had asked some of the high school indoor track athletes to help with the coaching and help show the students the different events and how to do the different events. And so I think they're assisting him with that, as well as Mr. Casey. And so far, it's busy. They're busy. And we certainly have a nice turnout for that. But they're moving along with it. And their first meet is Saturday, if anyone wants to attend.
It's a good way to spend every Saturday.
Yes.
We just completed the high school.
So now you're ready for it. You know the spot to sit in the
expo,
right?
I have one question on the industrial technology curriculum.
Yes.
Will Randy be picking up more classes because he's going to have more students coming in or not?
He will pick up an additional sixth grade class, and he will also, there'll be the seventh grade classes. The seventh grade are the class, is the class this year that has had 22 students in it, and that's where Donna Speckman, who is our instructional aide, has gone in and assisted in this class. Next year, those seventh grade classes will be 23 to 24. She will need to be in there again with him. The sixth grade classes this year, half of the sixth grade, half of the homeroom has gone to industrial technology, half of them have gone to life skills and health. Next year, our plan is to extend some of the library curriculum into the sixth grade so that they would be going half to industrial technology and half to the library in small groups to do some work with Hayden and also some extended work on projects from the teachers.
So this won't impact his fourth, fifth computer?
Well, the thing we need to remember about any of our allied arts staff that we're actually, they're picking up, I think the increase is, comes in the difference of the incoming fourth grade and the outgoing eighth grade, because they've actually had all the other students, and I believe it's an increase of about 40 students that they'll be doing, and all of them will be increasing their classes. Yes?
I'm not trying to prolong this, but I do want to just enter my comments into the discussion, and the discussion can be held later. I'm concerned about 23 students in the lab situation. I'm concerned about common planning time. I understand there is planning time, it's just not common planning time. I personally bought in heavy to the middle school concept, and I think that some of that concept could be diminished by some of these budgetary changes that I have to just at least take note of, so that if we could revisit them some before a final decision is made, I'd feel more comfortable. But I think the school board policy has stated there's an 18 maximum in the lab.
In the industrial technology lab, and that's a guideline that we use. If you have more students than that, you need to have another adult in there, and that's where we used our instructional aid this year to begin, and it's for safety reasons and precautions. Actually, I've been in the class a couple of times. There are enough stations. The lab is big enough for people to be in there, as long as you have enough adult supervision to make sure that everyone is safe as they're working with all the issues.
Thank you.
The seventh grade major project are with Metric 500 cars. And so they work with the machinery somewhat, but then there's a lot of painting, putting together, and doing those things. So they're not into some, it's not, I don't want anyone to get the impression it's a heavy industrial technology lab where they're trying to build bookcases and things like that. Those aren't the projects that they're working on.
They're just rocket propelled cars. 70 miles an hour.
And your son's is the fastest.
Well, is it still? I didn't know. I could still stay. You're ahead of me on that one.
The last thing just to mention, in athletics, we do have an increase in our request for coaches, and that is because we are requesting, and part of it is our indoor track coach that we would request outright in our budget next year, and also we are requesting a third coach for soccer, for basketball, and for the softball season. That is to meet the number of students that go out. If we don't have that many students out, we obviously wouldn't fill that position this year. We've had a floating coach in the past, and this year we used it in boys basketball, and we had a third basketball team, and that's to allow as many students to play as would like to play. As we look ahead at our enrollments and the classes getting larger, after talking with Andy Strout, we just felt that it would be prudent to just plan that we might need those coaches in each one of those sports to go through. Because it is our policy to allow as many students to go out for a sport as would like, and that we're not into championships, but it's the opportunity to play the sport.
Thank you.
I have one other question. Under the office of the principal, the secretary, is that because of the reduction?
Yes.
Okay, if there are no other questions from the board at this moment, I'd ask if anybody from the public ask any questions or make any comments. further.
Excuse me, Peter, one thing I forgot. In our maintenance account, a lot of which I'm not as conversant on as I probably should be, but one of our plans with the recommendation, if the recommendation is followed through to eliminate our life skills and health program, part of the money in there is to redo that room as our art room. We would not dismantle all of the kitchens. There are four kitchens in the life skills and health room, two of them on the outer walls. We would keep those kitchens, but the two center kitchens we would try to cover over in some way to use for the art room, and that would put all of our allied arts courses on the same floor, and it gives us another classroom to use for eighth grade instruction, which we could use up on the eighth grade floor. So that's one of the major things there, if that recommendation is followed.
Okay, thank you very much, Nancy. Thank you, Phil. No, I'm sorry.
No, it doesn't concern me. It's something that I believe Mr. LaBelle has to answer. Under plant operations and maintenance, since this comes under your budgetary account, why have we budgeted the same amount for electricity and water and that kind of stuff that we did this year? As I believe, our electricity has not been...
Based on current usage, I think, year-to-date, I think the way we're headed is that the electricity account will be overdrawn, but we should have the money saved up in the fuel oil account. What we'd like to do is Gary and I would like to sit down and leave the same monies we do have in the budget this year into next year, and we have a three-year backup or scenario to look at it on the computer and allocate the money to probably more appropriate accounts. I believe we were overdrawn last year in the utility account. We did fairly well in the fuel oil account. The price was up like almost double what it is this year. And then if there are to be any savings in the energy accounts, we would like at some point, once we go through the middle school renovations or whatever need be done, probably allocate some of the savings to probably update the system or do set up more points or systems out there where we could control the heating better.
I really do think that we should, on a historical basis, look back to see how things and truly reflect what those costs are. And not to have overages in this account and underages in this account. I mean, I think we can project quite accurately.
For next week, I'll have a three-year breakdown.
Okay.
Rosemary.
I keep thinking if I come to these meetings and I don't feel well, I won't speak, but I really have to speak. I just want to revisit the life skills health reduction. Also the cover memo that was sent to us regarding that some of the health curriculum can be integrated into physical education, science, and the advisee classes. I am sure that some of the health curriculum can be integrated. However, my concern is there seems to me to be a continuing increased demand on the phys ed, the science, and those teachers participating in the advisee curriculum. I am continued to be concerned about the fact that we're relying on a part-time nurse as one of our resources. Again, as outlined in this, I have concerns, as Charlie just mentioned, about our fuel oil account in the middle school, carrying some money that, in my view, could be better spent on a full-time nurse, and consideration of what happens to the scheduling and to the impact on other core areas, including the loss of common planning time at the middle school. And although I have said I would not resist that cut as vehemently as I have in the past, I still would like to have some discussion of what impact it will have. I am very concerned, and I've written a letter to the superintendent some time ago regarding my concern about the lack of AIDS education
and also the sensitivity in which it needs to be addressed. I also, serving on the community team, as a school board representative, are very, very aware of some of the drug, alcohol, and other problems that exist within the community, and it does not begin in the ninth grade. Again, these are all things that I've said in the past. I just feel that I have an opportunity sitting on the school board for the first time, and instead of hearing myself from the podium, and I would like to have those items considered again before we make a final decision. Thank you.
Thank you.
Just one more thing. I just need to go back to the number of remedial students in language arts and math. Do we have any idea why we have such a high number? Maybe you don't necessarily need to address that tonight, but I would.
We would be glad to look into that. To say right off, now, in the math program, as wonderful as our math program and moving to more transition math and more challenging math program and a faster paced math program has been fine for a majority of our students, there are some of our students who could do that programming but at a slower pace. Right now, we don't have the resources or personnel always to slow that down. Next year, we are looking at, is there a way to place students in classes so that maybe we can have one of our transition math classes, especially in the eighth grade, be a class that we know is going to be a two-year transition math class. They will do half of it in the middle school and then finish up in the high school. Those are decisions we would need to be ready to make grade by year by year, because next year's eighth grade may not need that kind of an offering, but the one following it may. I had a discussion today with Michael Efren about that very thing, about the high school being flexible too and being ready to say some years they may have a class that comes in that needs a two-year algebra program, and sometimes perhaps not. It would be our feeling right now that if students went through a two-year transitional math program, then they would go to a one-year algebra program. They wouldn't need 2 years in both programs. But that's our best estimate at this time. And so those are some of the kinds of things that we're looking at. And based on our programming, that I can tell you in mathematics, that as we have stepped up the expectations for that programming, it's been wonderful for the majority of our students, but we are concerned about some of our other students who aren't quite ready to go with that pace.
We really owe it to these kids to give them a math program that meets their needs. I mean, 17 kids in seventh grade, that's a whole class worth of kids. I mean, we really owe them something besides just a makeshift solution.
I have one question of Beth that jogged my memory when Rosemary was giving. Where is DARE in next year's budget? Program DARE. Isn't that in fifth grade? Some of it does come from the communities, from the community.
That to date has not been cut from the town budget. They provide the police officers to come into the school to do the but that's definitely on the table.
Okay, I think some of it's funded by the Cable Elizabeth Patrolmen's Association also.
We do not fund that.
Blind.
In the Lions Club, I'm speaking on the budget in front of the Lions Club next week. In fact, while I'm on that, I've asked Charlie to chair the next meeting. Am I speaking on Tuesday? Is that,
that was the day for the
conference. Yeah, it's the third. Yeah, so Charlie will chair the next session.
Has Quest been considered as an area where we could cover some of this health skills?
The Quest program is our advisor and advisee program in the sixth grade, so that we would do that. I'm not in conflict with what Rosemary said about the things picking up. It comes as a, if we put AIDS education into the seventh grade science curriculum, something has to move out in order to make room for it. Sometimes that's not a bad process or a negative process to go through, because it's good to go through your curriculums every so often and make sure you have the most important things in those. But they come at opportunity cost of something else. And we just have to review those very carefully and consider which of the opportunity costs can we take best.
Madam Superintendent, do you have any final words for us tonight? Wisdom or anything on the state situation?
Well, the state situation is interesting. We, as I think I've mentioned to a couple of you, had a chance to talk about. We did get a preliminary printout yesterday. Frankly, it makes De La Belle look like a pretty on-target guesser because it came in about 26,000 over what we had used as a target figure. However, I have to say that we were hoping it would be higher than that because, in fact, that means that the evaluation formula piece is just basically flattened out. We should get by any stretch of the business of the valuation, we should be getting a good bit more than that. That means, however, if that is a conservative figure, we assume that it is, it means that the figures that you've been presented with are fairly, you know, they're certainly within the ballpark. It also means that we're not going to get a lot of extra help from the state. So the decisions that you're faced with in the light of looking at our cover sheet with a 2% overall increase, but a 4% increase on the tax rate, and way of one of the suggestions that I did have originally with Nancy, we were looking at that budget, is that similar to perhaps the downsizing on the GT program, we could put some consultant money in there in the sense of trying to target some specific tutoring for certain students as needed, at least in some ways. But I really do believe we are in very stringent times. I mean, picking up the paper this morning, a proposal from the Portland School Committee. I don't know what is going to happen to that, but a 0% increase. I've had people speak to me about that.
There is a point I'd like to make about adding somebody for remedial reading. If we absolutely have to have that, and that has a very high priority, the fact that it doesn't exist does not automatically give it a lower priority than something that we already have. We might want to cut something in order to add that program. And that is always tough to do, whether you're in the private sector or the public sector, but these are tough times, and we may have to do precisely that sort of thing.
And especially if we're having problems in something as basic as reading, where we need remedial services.
Absolutely.
I agree with those things that have been stated. On the other hand, I think it's critical that we service students who have